going to be doing one of the most repaired clocks you'll probably see coming across your bench. It's an Ingraham's Time and Strike, and that's a Jungens that you hear in the background. This particular Ingraham's, it has a patent date of November 11th, 1879, and it looks like it still has its original springs in it. They're very rough finish springs. When you open them up, they almost feel like they're gravelly. It's just the metal processing that they went through back then. And the dial looks like it's been repaired once before. They put new paper on it. It's not original, but it's quite an old repair, so not too bad. And it's missing that little ornamental piece up at the top there. Customer would like me to see if I can find that. But we're going to be doing an overhaul on this one. Needs about 4 to 6 bushings on it. So here we go. First thing you see is that it has a count wheel instead of a snail, which is the majority of the Ingrahams out there. Something that's a little different because it's older. It's got tapered pins holding the plates together, as opposed to the little nuts that hold other ones together. First thing we're going to do is to relieve the power. I'm going to wind up the springs, and then I'm going to flip these springs off of the clicks. And then what I'll do is let down the springs on both sides. So here's that spring I was talking about, just like that. And then you make sure to have the clamp not all the way like this, but you want to have it back about this far when you release it, because you need to have this straight area completely released so it fits on that standoff later on. Okay. I released the click. The click moved away. And there it is. Okay. I like to push down on the standoffs and pull up with my fingers on the plates. As you can see, the escape wheel came up with it. And there we have the escape wheel. No broken. I had gone through the ultrasonic and I hand dried it. I put all the wheels back in their places. And what we're going to do next is to put the plates back together without the levers, to test for worn bushings. As you can see, no springs in the great wheels for the escape wheel cock to hold that bushing in place and also strengthen this area here when you push the bushing in. You don't want to be bending this up. There's a special tool for that. Let me show you. Here's the tool. It's just a stepped piece of brass with holes in it, and the steps are unequal left and right, so you can actually slide it in here when the escape wheel is out and be able to give a solid surface to the escape wheel cock there. First thing I do with the polishing is that I mount it inside of the appropriate chuck to hold the wheel properly and put it on the slowest setting. And first thing I do is just take out the Scotch-Brite and I lay it across the brass here while it's spinning, and I also clean up the steel. Never wrap this stuff around your finger because in case the wheel catches it, it's going to drag your finger right into it. So just kind of hold it loosely. In case something goes wrong, just let go of it and let it spin around and just shut off the lathe at your leisure then. And let's see if I can do one while I'm holding the camera. Might be difficult. And that cleans up the tarnish and all. Here's an interesting problem that I just came across. This is a lantern pinion with the trundles inside. Everything looks kind of normal, except this part of the lantern is very loose on the arbor. Can you see I'm moving it? And if I was to pull on it, all the trundles would fall out. Okay, we got it all assembled. Trundles look like they were in good shape. And that little, the half of the lantern pinion is good and tight now. Now we're going to clean it up and polish everything up, check out the pivots, check out the shoulders, make sure the no damage was done when we did the staking, and fix it up on the lathe. Okay, I got a reference point in the background. And as I turn the chuck of the lathe by hand, can you see that pivot? It's actually moving up and down very slightly. I got a feeling that someone previously had replaced this pivot, and possibly the pivot on the other side. And you can really amplify the error of the pivot by putting a stake onto the pivot that fits it loosely. And I'm going to turn it this way. Now watch that stake. That's the low side, that's the high side. So to straighten out this pivot, all we need to do is find the high side, which is right about there, and just bend it down a tiny bit until that stake pretty much stands still and it just rotates. It takes a little bit of trial and error. Got it pretty close right there. Can you see that? The end of the stake is pretty much standing still. For an American clock, that is more than enough. And here we have the completed job. I stoned off any kind of imperfections that the plier had done to the brass there to make it look nice. I shined everything up, polished the pivot, polished the wheel up. Looking good. Next case, here we have all the wheels back into the plates. Since this movement is hidden, I'm not going to bother polishing the plates themselves. But the wheels got polished. The mechanicalness of it is going to be 100% when I'm done. Okay, we're going to make this bushing fit this pivot properly. And the way we do that, just put in a five-sided brooch. Take a little bit of material out. I don't know if you can see that, a tiny bit of brass dust right there. What we're about to do is the final assembly. We're going to be installing the mainsprings, but before you do that, make sure that you oil the assembly holding the mainspring, the great wheel. Okay, we're back at the movement. In order to put the mainspring in, we have to take out some other things. Put the mainspring around that and feed it down. And pop the pivot in there, just like that. I got the movement sitting sideways now. Let's see if we can get a little bit better position so you can see it. This is the area that you want to be looking in. The minute arbor hook is going to come around and it's going to hit this lever upwards, put it into warning. As a matter of fact, I can do that manually just to show you what it looks like. Here we have a happy little movement. I just put one turn of wind on the time side. If you notice, I still got the spring clamps in there. There's nothing wrong with leaving them in there because you don't need that much power to do your testing. If the clock will only run when it's fully wound, well, you definitely got a problem then. It should run on one turn, in some cases just a quarter of a turn. Okay, as you can hear, it's out of beat. So we'll go ahead and put it in beat. I put the little, I call it a bow tie, a nice little tapered pin. And after you fit it so it reaches the end of the brass washer to make it look nice, you want to get rid of the diagonal cutter marks. So you then use a little diamond sintered plate on your little drill there, and you can flatten out the edges of that little tapered pen. Excellent. Here we have another clock brought back to life. The Ingraham Time and Strike. There's the top piece that I made for them. I used some Australian oak wood, and I think it was spalted. Came out quite nice.